Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Practical Nutrition. I'm Alex Shantz.
I'm Cassie Dimmick.
And I'm Sarah Kostelnik.
And today our topic is organic versus non-organic, and does it matter? So we hear a lot, especially being dietitians, about what organic means. Do I need to be buying organic? And it's everywhere, in the grocery store, the farmer's market. I mean, we look left and right and it says organic. So today we're just going to break it down, dive in, and kind of talk about, do we need to be eating organic, or does it really matter? So USDA organic foods must be grown and processed according to federal guidelines addressing soil quality, animal raising practices, pest and weed control, and additives. So it's very specific. They have a very specific guideline that you have to follow. So USDA organic, that label that you want to look for, which we don't have one with us, but we'll post it on our social media. You want to look for that label whenever you can. They have to use natural substances on fruits and veggies, grains, dairy, and meat in accordance with the USDA strict guidelines, and rely on physical, mechanical, or biological-based farming practices. So again, lots of strict guidelines to follow to be able to earn that USDA organic label. And there is some research with some pesticides, I guess you could say, on organic food, but all of it's natural pesticides. It's not ones that are necessarily going to cause harm. So any research that I've seen has had those natural types of pesticides in them, if there's any at all. So we're going to dive into more so when using organic practices. It has been shown to take it away, Cassie.
Yes. So you may have heard some things you maybe thought were rumors, you know, like, yeah, it's better for the environment, but guess what? It is better for the environment.
Yes.
And so organic food actually does enhance soil and water quality. And, you know, as we all know, we only have one earth, and so yes, we need to take care of it. So it is better for the soil and water. It also, just in general, is better for the environment. And thinking about animals, it also provides safe and healthy livestock habits. I don't know if any of you guys have ever seen or read about some of the ways that they either treat animals or what they do whenever it's non-organic. And organic foods, especially meats, they have rules for how they can treat the animals, what they can do to them, and what they can feed them. And so it controls that more. And then also self-sustaining cycle of resources is what it promotes. And that's something that we need to think about just for future generations. And so that's important. And when we're looking at, you know, organic crop farming versus livestock, you know, organic crop farming includes plant rotation. So they have, you know, things that they do to that maybe was what they used to do way back in the day before we had some of the massive, you know, farming. But they rotate plants to preserve soil quality so it doesn't deplete the soil of the nutrients as much. And they also use cover crops to prevent erosion, which is a benefit to the environment. Mulch to control weeds instead of spraying things to kill weeds. And then, you know, and they also control predatory insects. They have predatory insects to control pests. And so, again, like Alex said, they don't use the prohibitive substances to control the environment of the plant. Some natural pesticides are used, but they have to be approved. And produce is called organic when it's certified to have been grown in soil that has no prohibitive substances for 3 years prior to harvest. So that's something important to know as well. Organic farming and livestock includes, I'll pass it on.
Yes, yes. Hey, no, keep talking, guys. We love to hear you talk. I love it. So Cassie talked about crop farming, which again, more of that produce type. Now we're going to talk about livestock a little bit. So healthy living conditions for livestock. Those livestock have access to outdoors, pasture feeding for at least 30% of livestock's nutritional needs. They're fed organic food and they have healthy vaccinations. So as we know, whatever the animal eats is what we eat. So it's important to keep that in mind. And whenever you're picking things, choose organic, USDA organic when you can. Certified organic beef includes access to pastures during a minimum of 120-day grazing season, and they have no growth hormones. Labels of free-range and hormone-free, which we hear about a lot, do not indicate a producer followed all guidelines for organic certification. Majority of beef is conventionally raised. I think it's about 98% conventionally raised. Begin life by grazing in grassy pastures, but are then packed into feedlots and fed mostly corn and soybeans for 3 months to almost a year. So if we aren't doing USDA organic beef, poultry, that sort of thing, then they are said to be raised in that sort of environment. So again, important to check where you're getting your animal proteins from. The animals may also have been given antibiotics and hormones. So again, if they're conventionally raised, not necessarily organically raised, then that is part of that as well. So you want to look for grass-fed organic, which we're talking about beef in this at this point. Grass-fed organic beef is going to be your number one pick. Like I mentioned earlier, we are what we eat, so it's important to understand where these animals are coming from.
And I just want to mention one quick thing about that, because I get so frustrated when I see labels in the store, and when Alex was talking about looking for organic, and when you're looking for grass-fed, you want to look for 100%, and you know that they are organic, and because they can be very tricky about antibiotic use. I've seen on turkey, for example, they would say no antibiotics used for growth promotion. Well, what does that mean? Right. You know, they don't give antibiotics typically to promote growth. So that doesn't mean that they didn't give them to prevent illness, which is what they usually give them for.
Right.
And so it makes it seem like they didn't use antibiotics, but they did. And so the word organic is really important, because those antibiotics, like Alex said, do show up in the meat. And then you ingest them. So we do know that. And so it's important to really look at the food. And if you have a question about any of that or something seems confusing, you can always message us and ask us, and we're happy to help.
Yes. Good point, Cassie. That's a great point. So we're moving into potential benefits of making the switch to some organic types of foods. And Sarah is going to help us out with that.
Yes. So we talked about what it means to be organic for the most part, what things to look for, and now we're going to talk about the does it matter portion of it. So yes, we wouldn't be talking about it if it didn't matter. So there are potential benefits for making the switch, and I've said it before, I'll say it again, we are research and evidence-based. So we want you all to know what the research says. That's our job to break it down for you. So research has shown that there are some potential benefits. We'll go over a couple. I'm specifically going to hit two in terms of, is it better to choose organic versus conventionally grown foods? And while these studies do show differences, it can't be concluded, which most research normally says, it cannot be fully concluded that it translates into overall health benefits of an individual, because we're all made differently, right? So how it affects one person is going to be different than the other. First and foremost, which is, I feel like, one of the things that we talk about a lot, especially with beef and meat and all that stuff, is the omega-3 content. As we know, omega-3s are the healthful fats that we typically get less of compared to omega-6s and saturated fats and all of that stuff. But the feeding recommendations for organic livestock farming results in generally higher levels of omega-3 fatty acids, especially in organic meats, dairy, and eggs. And like I said, research shows that higher consumption of omega-3s leads to decreased risk of cardiovascular disease, lowering your blood pressure, reducing triglycerides, all things that we as dietitians and other healthcare professionals want to see our clients have. The second thing is that it's better for the environment. And Cassie mentioned this, and I think this is one of the things that is important to know about organic foods, because even if research doesn't necessarily show that we may reap all of these huge benefits, Cassie said, we have one earth, we want to treat it right. So just so you all know, organic farming is considered to be more sustainable. It's a more sustainable alternative when it comes to food production because of all of those things that we listed beforehand. A lack of pesticides, wider variety in plants enhances biodiversity and results in better soil quality. All those things that we learned about in biology or whatever elementary school science class you had that we probably all forgot about. And then reducing pollution from fertilizer or pesticide runoff. So it's more than just helping ourselves, we're also helping the environment.
That's awesome. Yes. So those are just a couple potential benefits. Other potential benefits, which are shown by research, lower chance of toxic metals. I mean, sign me up. So cadmium is really well studied. It's a toxic chemical found in soils and absorbed by plants. Studies show significantly lower cadmium levels in organic grains versus conventionally grown crops. So typically seen a lot more in like rice. So if you're eating that rice and if it's not organic, there could be a potential chance that it's high in cadmium, which if you have too much exposure to that can lead to CKD, which is hard on your kidneys, osteoporosis, diabetes, CVD, some cancers. So this is what research has shown. We need more longevity studies on cadmium, and if we're ingest how much of it is going to cause this and those types of things. But research, preliminary research that I have seen show those, if we have too much cadmium, those things can be a result. So definitely if we're going organic, we have a lower chance of getting a toxic such as cadmium. Not saying that if you don't do organic, you're going to have these things, but research shows that you could have a higher chance. And then also decreased pesticide residue. Compared with conventionally grown produce, organic has lower detectable levels of pesticides residue. Even though both types of farming use pesticides, organic is mostly found to be natural. Obviously, if you're growing organic and conventional in the same area, it can be a little bit harder for farmers to keep those separate, but a lot of the times you're gonna get a much lower chance of pesticide residue in your organic produce. And if there is, it's gonna be more of a natural source. The difference in health outcomes, again, is unclear, like Sarah has mentioned, but overall, lower pesticides, lower toxins, better for the environment, higher in omega-3, so a little bit more nutrient dense. Organic has a lot of benefits. And pesticide excretion studies have consistently shown a reduction in urinary pesticide metabolites with an organic diet. However, this is insufficient evidence to show the translation and a clinically relevant health outcomes. Most research needed on pesticide exposure versus measurable health outcomes is needed. So always more research is good, but preliminary stuff that we have seen, and even dating back to the earlier 2000s, 90s, we've seen that cadmium is really prominent in pesticide residue and non-organic sources of food. So Cassie's gonna move us into our next study here.
Yes, this is an interesting study for us dietitians. So, and this is a meta-analysis, so it's looking at a lot of different studies, 343 peer-reviewed studies to be exact, was what this one looked at. And so, so this is really trying to answer the big question that we get, well, is organic produce healthier than non-organic? And we already talked about things that you potentially won't get if you get organic stuff, and that might be good, but we still don't know if we know you get pesticides from conventional produce, but is that a negative, big negative thing? We don't really know. But this is something that's shown to be a possible benefit that you would get in antioxidants. So they looked at antioxidants and they found, and these are things that, again, are healthy that you get from fruits and veggies, but they are substantially higher in organic crops and crop-based foods. Flavanols and anthocyanins, for example, are some, and that's like things in blueberries and, again, all those fruits and veggies we want you to eat. And those help decrease free radicals in your body, which is a benefit for preventing inflammation and heart disease and cancer and all those good things. So you get more concentration, what this is showing, in fruits and veggies that are organic than you would get from non-organic. So that's important. You get more bang for your buck. And it makes sense if you know that the reason that these plants have these things is these are often bitter tasting, and it's their own natural defense against the pests that eat them. And so if you've ever tasted something like kale or some of those dark green leafy veggies, they have that bitter taste, and those typically are going to have higher amounts of antioxidants. And guess what? The grasshoppers may not like that as much either. So we may not like it, but they don't either. Yeah. And so it's a natural defense. And so it kind of makes sense over the years that if we are making that irrelevant for plants to have because they're going to have pesticides sprayed all over them, they may produce less of those. And so if that makes sense. And so to me, that's not something that's been proven of why, but that's one theory. And to me, that makes a lot of sense for why maybe the conventionally raised things are losing that benefit because they don't need it as much because we're spraying the pesticides for them. Mm-hmm. So that's one potential benefit. And so also the frequency of occurrence of pesticide residues was found to be 4 times higher in conventional crops, which also contain significantly higher concentrations of the toxic metal cadmium, which is what Alex just talked about. So you are going to get some of those potentially harmful things in conventional produce. And then on the flip side, in organic, you're going to get more of the beneficial things. And so that's that is pretty astounding. So organic crops, on average, have higher concentrations of antioxidants, lower concentrations of cadmium, and a lower incidence of pesticide residues than non-organic comparators. So that's, to me, very exciting.
Yes. And
definitely a reason why you would want to choose organic when you can.
Yes, absolutely. And that's another thing too. I'm going to bring it back to the phytonutrients that Cassie was talking about. Whenever we eat fruits and veggies in their natural state, we get those phytonutrients. A lot of times if clients are doing like juices and that kind of stuff, we're not going to get those benefits. That's why we always try to promote whole fruits and veggies whenever we can, so we can seek those benefits. And is it truly organic? We got to check the label. And we're going to talk a little bit about that right now, because it can be very confusing. There's different ways people say organic and different ways people advertise their products. So I'm going to have Sarah go into that a little bit.
One of the great things I like about things that are overseen by the USDA, the Department of Agriculture, is that they are regulated, unlike things like supplements where we don't necessarily know what's in something, how much, all of that stuff. So because the term organic is overseen by the USDA, we know whether it's organic, if it uses all organic products. Cassie mentioned looking for 100% organic. We know that, which is great. And so we're going to teach you guys how to know that as well and what to look for at the store. So there is actually a certification program to certify your products as organic. And that requires that all organic foods meet extremely strict government standards. And it regulates things like how the foods are grown, handled, and processed. So all that stuff that we talked about in the introduction of this podcast. One interesting thing, which is kind of cool, is that there are an exception for producers who sell lower volume, so less than $5,000 a year in organic foods. They still have to follow all of the guidelines that are required to call your foods organic, but they don't have to go through that certification process. So they can't use the USDA organic seal, but they can still refer to their products as organic. And then there are different things to look for on packaging for whether or not it's organic, how much is organic. So I'll give you guys two of them, and then Alex will give you guys the rest of them. So there are a couple, so stick with us as we go through this for you, because it is really beneficial. So the first and foremost, the best one is 100% organic, right? So that means that everything that you are consuming is organic. It's certified by the USDA. It has that seal. This mainly includes things like fruits and vegetables, eggs, meats, or other single ingredient foods, but it can also be used on multi-ingredient foods if all of them are certified organic, except for salt and water. So salt and water do not have to be certified organic. And so they will have that USDA seal, which, like we said, we'll post a picture of that for you guys so you know what exactly that looks like. Moving down from that is the term organic. So if a product has organic listed on it, this means that multi-ingredient products have at least 95%, so not 100%, but just 95% of the ingredients certified organic, excluding, again, salt and water. And the non-organic items must be from a USDA list of approved additional ingredients, and they can still use that seal. So again, still very strict.
Yes. So the first two, again, 100% organic and organic, have the seal. Can use the seal because it's 95% or above, the ingredients are organic. Okay. Now we're at made with organic, which we see this one quite a bit. It's multi-ingredient products. At least 70% of the ingredients are certified organic. So those 70% organic ingredients, what about the other 30%? We don't know. It can be whatever. May have a made with organic ingredients label if you've reached that 70%. So example, we see this in breakfast cereals a lot. Sometimes if we're walking down that aisle and it says made with organic, we might grab that cereal. But does it have 60 grams of sugar per serving? We don't know. But it's got 70% organic. So something to consider there. So with that, they don't have a seal on that one. Didn't earn the seal. The next one is organic ingredients, so has organic ingredients in it. It has less than 70% of a multi-ingredient product, but is certified organic. It may not use the label, though, or carry any sort of seal. The ingredient list can indicate which ingredients are organic. So again, less than 70% of their ingredients, it could have two ingredients on it, it could have one ingredient that's organic. Less than 70%, they can say that it contains organic ingredients. And then we also hear about natural ingredients. Natural and organic are not synonymous, so try not to confuse them. I mean, it makes it, the food industry makes it so confusing, and we're trying to decipher it a little bit. But it is not the same thing. It's not interchangeable. Natural does not speak to the methods and materials used to produce ingredients or flavors it promotes. So we hear a lot about like natural flavors and natural foods and all this type of stuff, and it's kind of a buzzword recently. So we just want you to be aware that organic and natural are not the same thing, and they're not interchangeable. So, to answer the question, Cassie, do we buy organic? What do we do?
So, yes. And the answer is yes, if you can. It may be pricey. You know, if you've noticed, organic foods typically are more expensive. Not always, but often they are. And part of that's because they do take more money to produce. And so they also have to be certified, you know. So you are paying for what you get in a lot of cases. So, you know, but again, look at your budget. It's always better to eat fruits and veggies that are non-organic than to not eat them at all. So we don't want to scare you from eating fruits and veggies and think you're going to get heavy metal poisoning or pesticides. Yeah. Or anything like that. We know that eating zero organic foods, if you eat healthy foods, you're going to get a benefit from that. So you need to eat them either way. And, you know, look at the prices and you can compare things that you're eating the skin on, things that are grown underground. Those typically have higher pesticide residues. And so that might be something that you pick to eat organic. And so things that you peel, like a banana, for example, isn't going to be as big of a deal to eat non-organic. It still isn't great for the environment, but sometimes it becomes cost prohibitive, and that's okay. So you don't have to feel bad about that. We want you to eat your fruits and veggies. But we do know, just because, again, to remind you that they have less contaminants, less pesticides, and in some cases are more nutrient dense. So we think that's a benefit. Again, more research is needed, but those things, you know, are pretty consistent in what we've seen. And so, you know, getting your fruits and veggie variety and balance is the most important thing. And then helping to save money, you can think about, you know, buying those things that you're eating every day that are organic. So like my kids love apples, you know, so that's something that you eat the skin on. So I try to buy organic of those. Also, a lot of people think just produce, which we've talked about a lot, but there are a lot of benefits from your dairy products and meat. So I do try to buy those organic when possible, especially when you're buying full fat dairy or meats that have fat in them, because of that fat profile being so much healthier. That's another reason. You can also, you know, things like Sam's and farmers markets, you know, you can go to places that maybe you can get things in bulk or things that are in season and save money that way. And then the labels, really look at those, because the food industry is extremely sneaky. They might put made with in tiny letters and organic in really big letters. You know, that's a common one. And so you have to be sure to look at the label and see. But that word organic is protected. They can't put that on there unless it, you know, complies with something. And so if they have the seal, you know, that's going to have the highest standard. And then again, that in-season produce in the winter time isn't going to be the best time to find organic strawberries and not pay $9 for, right, you know, two servings. So, you know, so, but thinking about it too, you know, as a bottom line is what you're eating is an investment in your health. And so, you know, if you go buy organic produce and you spend a little more money and maybe skip the chips and the sodas and some of the other things, you know, then you'll get a lot more for your money. And so that's something that, you know, you always want to think about, just not, oh my gosh, I can't believe that $6 for these blueberries. Well, what are you getting for that $6?
Right. Yeah. That's awesome. Yes. So to answer the big question, like Cassie just said, if you can buy organic, yes, try to at least pick fruits, veggies, meats, dairy, those types of things that are beneficial to buy in organic. So anything else to add?
I think that wraps it up.
Okay. Well, if you have any questions, let us know. Ask us on Instagram. We're going to post all this on our social media. So we will see you next time.
Thank you.
Thanks.